Good afternoon, folks. Michael Phillips, film critic of the Chicago Tribune here for Real Thursdays. And today I'm with Erica Olson of Redbox, the movie columnist and movie critic. How are you doing?
Great. How are you?
Good. We're going to talk about Oz the Great and Powerful. And this is a film that's opening tomorrow. It's just to set the scene. It's a big Disney project, much like Alice in Wonderland a couple of years ago, three or four years ago now. And, in that you have a very, very well-loved property. You have a very, very large amount of cash thrown at it, about $200 million, as they did with Alice in Wonderland. And they're hoping to get a very, very large return in the neighborhood of $1 billion if they could.
$1 billion, yes.
As they did with Alice in Wonderland. I know what I thought of it, and we'll talk about that in a second, but you were where on this, on Oz the Great and Powerful? Where?
You know, it's the type of thing where I try and usually go into movies without any preconceived notions, you know, without any opinions. It's very hard to do that with something where it's a prequel to one of the most cherished movies of all time. So when I heard it was in 3D, I was concerned, usually not the biggest fan of 3D. When I saw that there were a lot of CGI characters as kind of main characters, that concerned me as well. And then with James Franco in the lead, I thought that could be, you know, kind of a toss-up. I'm happy to say I was pleasantly surprised.
Really?
Especially with the 3D, just let me get it out of the way, I thought the opening, there's an opening credit sequence that I just thought was gorgeous, magical, used 3D very well. But, you know, a lot of kids are going to be seeing this movie, and whether they saw the original or not, kids like 3D to do what they expect, which is have stuff jump out at them.
Right.
And it did that as well. And I am not too proud to admit that there were at least two times during the film that I actually did do the duck and cover.
And whatever one thinks of the movie, it is a 3D film that was actually shot ground up in 3D. It's not some sort of sloppy post-production conversion, which is just simply to get the upcharge from the audience. But this is I would actually say, although I did not like the film, I think as much as you did.
Okay.
I would say that in this one, because you're dealing with a real director, Sam Raimi, you have somebody who's actually got an idea or two and kind of a sense of humor about how to use the 3D.
Right.
In that some of it is just sort of the zap effects where things are being flung at your head, essentially. But a lot of it is just for depth and all that.
Yeah.
But now, I mean, what did you think of Franco, honestly, as this, we should set the scene here.
Sure.
It begins in 1905, Kansas. The character nicknamed Oz is this kind of like Weasley Carney Barker magician who's in a traveling tent show. And like the original 1939 film, we have, based on the L. Frank Baum books, we have this black and white, in the original's case, sepia, a black and white prologue shot in 1:33, nice square image, old style movie. And when he gets whisked off to Oz always with the tornadoes in Kansas, always.
Can't get there unless you're in a tornado.
Always a problem. It's the only way to get to Oz. Then, of course, the screen widens and
color
and the rest of them, and 3 and all 3D. But Franco is going to be the splitter on this,
I think. Either going to love him or hate him. I feel that one thing that surprised me was that he was a little bit more of a womanizer than I was expecting. You know, if you've seen the original, then you know that clearly he's a little bit of a con man, a little bit of a trickster. He certainly had his way with the ladies in this one, you know, both in the kind of prologue in Kansas and then also when he gets to Oz, he meets various three different witches, one of whom we already know, Glinda, played by Michelle Williams. And, you know, he's definitely a flirt. So that kind of threw me a little bit. But I did feel like he was a lot funnier than I thought he was going to be. And that's what it needed.
This is the thing with Franco. He never, to me, ever seems like he's in 1905 anything.
Okay.
You know, Kansas or Oz.
Right,
It's essentially like as if Bill or Ted and their excellent adventure just happened
That's
to kind of pick up this story.
Movie.
No, I like it too. But you're getting what aren't you getting from this performance? Any kind of the kind of thing that many people have thrown out names like, what if the young Kevin Klein had played it? What if Robert Downey Jr., who was in fact originally
in talks
to do this
that
role?
That I agree, you might have been better.
Yeah, and yet Franco does have that sense. And again, it's a mixed result here, but you have that sense watching him that he's just such a kind of an enjoyable goofball and having a good time. He kind of lightens the load of all this blockbuster machinery. Now, I got to say, toward the end, after the 15th fireball and, you know, Harry Potter style,
right,
you know,
sure,
sort of square off between the, you know, the bad witches and the good people, I got a little weary, and you don't have a sense that the story really had much new. And I mean, is there really a fresh enough variation to say, does this stand any chance of being held in the same esteem as the 1939 classic that we know?
No. I mean, I don't think it does. Even though I enjoyed the film, it is, you know, I don't think by any means going to become a classic. I think the other issue here is when you're dealing with a prequel, for people that have seen the original, it's very hard to kind of keep the suspense of what is going to happen, to certain, because you know what's going to happen. You know certain of these characters are decades later in, you know, in Oz still,
the story
or whatever.
We know.
So,
yeah.
You know, I feel like, to your point, the 10 bazillion fireballs were certainly for the audience that has grown up with Harry Potter.
More of a fireball-friendly audience.
Yeah, Pirates of the Caribbean, I think it would be another one that would come to mind of some of the, you know, younger kids that they're trying to attract. Of course, you've got the flying baboons in this case, and a flying monkey,
which are really scary. I mean, flying baboons are
much
scarier, far more frightening.
Be warned.
And
yeah.
I do think you're going to get a lot of shrieking preteens almost at every available screening in America this weekend, because this is where you have a little bit of the sense of the old Sam Raimi, who directed things like The Evil Dead, The Evil Dead 2, more recently Drag Me to Hell.
Yeah.
I did worry that. Even though Raimi's also done the Spider-Man trilogy.
Right.
Yeah,
sure.
So he's got kind of...
He knows family-friendly.
Yeah, he can play both sides of the fence, but he's a little bit of a subversive, and he's got kind of a nasty sense of humor. It makes some of this movie kind of interesting in a way. Because,
I certainly thought that it was... when I was saying that Franco was funny, I also thought he was a little bit more sarcastic. There's a sidekick flying monkey who's voiced by Zach Braff, and he's also, more cynical than I would have expected for a movie like this. And I did, laugh several times. So I felt like, they pulled it off in that sense. One other thing I wanted to mention, though, is that, it's set up as kind of the story of how the wizard got there.
Mm-hmm.
And I won't, give anything away, but there's also kind of the introduction of the Wicked Witch. And to me, that's one of the most classic villains of all time.
Right.
And to me, if I did have, a complaint about the film, it would be that I felt that was very anticlimactic. I felt like that reveal didn't really make a lot of sense to me.
I almost wondered this, Erica. Did they kind of dodge some of that because the Broadway musical Wicked.
Yeah, they didn't want to go there.
Which deals so intensely with that sort of this other kind of prequel notion.
Yeah.
And I almost wonder, too, if that's not kind of undermining your own point a little bit about like, if it's a prequel, we know where it's going. I mean, people walk into Wicked kind of just adoring all that Oz mythology. What is it about this story that we keep coming back to? What is it?
Well, I think what they tried to do in this film to capture that magic, but they did, fail, at least when compared to the original, is kids can watch the original and see one thing and see one story and learn certain lessons. Adults can watch that movie, the 1939 original, or watch it several times, growing up, and start to see so many other layers, themes about friendship, themes about, feeling like you need to tell somebody they're courageous when really they already are. Like when you think about the original, sure, it was Dorothy's journey, but there were kind of sub-themes and lessons learned and morals for the Tin Man, the Lion, and the Scarecrow as well. Here, I think they were still trying to kind of go with some of those friendship themes and good versus evil, but it wasn't that deep. I don't think that adults are going to kind of walk away with any kind of, feeling like they've been impacted.
No, and as you say, it's more of, if it's about anything, if this script's sort of got anything primarily in mind, it's more about this idea of like, how do you humanize a womanizer or turn him into a better person, So it's all about self-improvement,
But
I was mixed on it. I'd say you were a little more than mixed.
I did enjoy it. And I have to admit that a lot of that was because I did have very low expectations going in. I just feel like when you're dealing with this kind of material, even though it's not a remake, but it is still that universe of Oz that is so cherished, I just was very nervous.
Is that the key to movie going, do you think? Just having terrible expectations of everything?
These days, I don't know, maybe.
It can't hurt, right?
But I will say, for the really big Oz fans out there, there were a lot of very subtle, so I liked them, nods. look for the horse of a different color in the background where somewhere. I saw nods to the lion. I saw nods to the scarecrow. There was one for the Tin Man. I missed it, but I did feel like they were respectful in that sense of, you know, kind of alluding to the original story without pandering.
Well, not going too far, because they also, there's an awful lot of legal issues about, like,
yes, very tricky.
So from the prequel, we go to this notion of how do you sustain a monster franchise like, say, for example, Iron Man. Okay, we've had Iron Man 1, Iron Man 2. I think we can now take a look at the trailer for Iron Man 3, and then we'll kind of do the...
I have lots of opinions.
The Thursday afternoon quarterbacking before the game.
Sure.
Tony Stark. I build neat stuff. I got a great girl. And occasionally, save the world. So why can't I sleep?
You elected me on a single platform. I will defend this country at all costs. The Mandarin must be stopped.
You don't know who I am. You'll never see me coming.
What are you going to do about these attacks?
The whole world's going to be watching.
The question, where is Tony Stark?
Things are different now. I have to protect the one thing that I can't live without.
That's you. Mr. Stark.
Today is the first day of what's left of your life.
Go!
I'm gonna offer a choice. Do you want an empty life or a meaningful death?
You're not a man. You're nothing more than a maniac.
I'm not afraid of you. No politics here.
Just good old-fashioned revenge.
You need backup.
That's your department.
Here's my boys.
I'm taking the entire month of May off just to mentally prepare for Iron Man 3. And this is a sure, it just feels like one of these sure things at the box office.
Yeah.
I guess the question is, can they get back, for me, the question is, can they get back to the spirit of the first film, which was such fun and really kind of a surprise, just because you didn't really think of somebody like Robert Downey Jr. anchoring a superhero franchise.
Right.
But he brought this great light touch. The director, Jon Favreau, of the first picture, did not have, I would say, amazing action chops as a director, but that film really moved, and it had personality. The second one, I thought, felt much more like Hollywood insider, you know, jokes, and just it was all about basically kind of, well, what happens when a guy turns into a celebrity and starts acting like a boor?
Yeah,
I don't need to see an Iron Man movie to kind of figure that one out. But the third one, we'll see. I mean, but you're kind of an Iron Man geek, are you?
Yeah, and you know, I feel like what... First off, it's pretty clear that they have set a darker tone. So, you know, I agree with you that I was blown away with the first one. I thought they have now raised the bar for, you know, superhero movies. Second one, not so much. But now the interesting thing is, you know, they set this darker tone, but it is also set after the events of the Avengers. So Tony has, at the end of that movie, you know, almost sacrificed himself with, you know, carrying a nuclear missile up into the sky, thinking he might die. He's clearly shaken from that. He's clearly now realizing, okay, Pepper, Gwyneth Paltrow, Pepper Potts, you know, he loves, he wants to protect her. And I think he's realizing that there are kind of forces beyond his control. So the problem, though, is that now he's got this new threat in the form of the Mandarin, which in the comic books is actually his biggest archenemy ever. And he was alluded to a little bit in the first film. I don't know if you remember, but the terrorist organization that Stark and Iron Man were fighting at that time was called the Ten Rings. Oh, right. And so, you know, the Mandarin had, like, his Ten Rings on. In the comic book, he has alien, you know, powers from them. I'm not sure if that will be in the case in the movie. But there's kind of two things that I think they have to pull off here. One is making this battle, you know, between Iron Man and the Mandarin personal enough so that it makes sense that Tony wouldn't call up the Avengers again and say, okay, hey, come help me out. Right. I mean, they just helped him save the world. This has got to be something where he feels like he can either take it on his own or take it on with, you know, a few of his sidekicks in the film. The second would be Ben Kingsley in the role, you know, himself. If he needs to pull this off, because you know, this is once again a major, major villain, Iron Man's biggest enemy. And if Kingsley is not really able to kind of fulfill the expectations, I think, of, you know, the hardcore fans out there, I think that, you know, that it could be iffy. The storyline appears to have been drawn from also an arc in the comic books. I'm probably going to pronounce this wrong. It's either Extremis, or if you want to go all Latin, in Extremis. Okay. But it's basically, you know, there was that one scene in the trailer where Tony seemed to be pulling his suit onto him, like from afar. That is basically what this virus does, is it allows him to kind of connect kind of be one with his suit. There was also a scene where there was a bunch of people in harnesses, and I believe that the bad guys are also going to be trying to inject this virus into people to see if they can kind of remotely control some of this Iron Man army that,
right,
you know,
so
we saw.
But here's my question from the trailer.
Yes.
If filmmakers always frame the challenge of a sequel to a film like to a superhero franchise movie,
sure,
like this way, we're going, quote, darker, as
yeah,
we say, meaner, and so often you just get a movie that's essentially more violent, mm-hmm, and a little more off-putting, but not really more exciting. And
right,
so who knows from the trailer?
Right.
And look, we're not reviewing the trailer,
because
that's
right,
you
yeah
know,
it's
the trailer's job to make it look unmissable.
Sure.
And completely familiar at the same time.
Right.
So,
yep,
so it's not to scare off any of the fan base,
right,
but also maybe entice the other people. But I guess that's my it's almost my dare to filmmakers to kind of take on a movie like this and not just simply up the violence every time.
Right, right.
And I mean, sometimes you get a movie that has an insane body count, like that last Avengers, you know,
yeah,
the gang comedy Avengers, the one,
sure,
with everybody in it. But that film actually, for what it was, I thought it was effective,
yeah,
and pretty satisfying.
Yeah. Agreed.
I don't know. I also think I want to ask you about this. Robert Downey Jr., mm-hmm, so such a clever and such a droll actor. There's a very fine line with him, though, about being understated and wry and completely checking out and cashing the paycheck visibly on screen,
right,
and not caring.
That's what I felt like in Iron Man 2. I felt like it was kind of calling it in a little bit.
Yeah.
So, you know, here the question will be, you know, everybody still gravitates towards Tony Stark and Iron Man and Robert Downey Jr. in that role, because I feel like there's a lot of his real personality, quite frankly, that melts,
right,
over, you know, kind,
right,
of that cockiness, one-liner, you know, spouting, a little bit arrogant, and people are drawn to that. And I think that, you know, even though this trailer looks a little bit darker, I hope that they don't lose what kind of made everybody love him in the first place, which was that. I hope he doesn't start kind of taking himself too seriously,
right,
and that it's like this, you know, becomes, when that very beginning of the trailer when it says, you know, so why can I sleep at night? I've got all these great things going on. my first thought was, oh, please do not have this be like the Iron Man, you know, midlife crisis movie.
We just had it with Iron Man 2, right? Yeah.
I think I'm hoping that, you know, they really seem to have thrown, at the end, there was that kind of big suit that came out that's, yeah. I believe, called the Hulkbuster, as far as he has a whole bunch of different kind of suits.
Wow, you're on.
Yeah, well, have, no, I just feel the like they're making things. Sure that they're kind of throwing in, you know, some things for the people that have read the books and the right. comic books. So I think that they're making an effort. I personally did enjoy the trailer. I have high hopes.
Yeah.
So we'll see.
The only thing I would say in that, though, is that anytime there's a line that says this is not about politics, it usually means it's about politics
right.
in some
yeah.
way. So we'll see.
Yeah.
But we'll leave it there. Erica Olson, thank you for coming.
Thanks for having me.
And we'll see you on Real Thursdays next Thursday.